I love this passage of scripture. There's more to come. We continue to shout our praise even when we're hemmed in with troubles, because we know how troubles can develop passionate patience in us, and how that patience in turn forges the tempered steel of virtue, keeping us alert for whatever God will do next. In alert expectancy such as this, we're never left feeling shortchanged. Quite the contrary. We can't round up enough containers to hold everything that God generously pours into our lives through the Holy Spirit. Oh man, I just think Jesus is so awesome. Do you know what I like about Jesus? He always does more than you think he's going to do. You know, I love how David said in the psalm, he said, "My cup runneth over. My cup runneth over." In other words, God doesn't just fill your cup. He fills your cup so full it overflows. Jesus is this person who always does it. He'll always do something great, but then he'll do something greater after he does something great. I love it. Like, for instance, the crucifixion. We know the crucifixion was great because Jesus paid the penalty for our sins on that cross. That was great what he did. But let me tell you what was greater. 3 days later, when he rose up from the grave, that was greater. Jesus is always doing more than what we thought he would do. He's always beneficial. Can I tell you something? I love to treat my kids like this. How many of y'all like to bless your kids? How many of y'all will admit that in some cases you may have spoiled your children? How many would admit that in most cases your children are spoiled? Let's just say that. Okay, God help us. Anyway, we've always liked to trick our kids. I say trick because I really do believe that it's important to trick your kids on a regular basis. It keeps them off balance. Somebody say amen. You know, don't let them always have the advantage on you. You make them be unbalanced once in a while. Come on, especially when they get adolescent, you keep them off their, they're like, I don't know what to think about my parents. That's good. You want them thinking like that. But I love to always tease my kids at Christmas, because my goal at Christmas is to make my children cry. I truly, sincerely, if I could make one of my children bawl on Christmas morning, that is for the year, I'm good. I love it. And what I mean by that is I always want to bless them in such a way, like a more than enough way, that it moves them. Like, I can't believe you did this for me. Now, one of the ways I do that is I kind of trick them into thinking I'm not going to get that one big thing. Is this kind of cruel and mean? So here, one year it was with Taylor, with her Taylor guitar. It's when she first started leading worship, and she was getting some pretty big opportunities, and man, and she wanted to learn the guitar, and she had gotten an old guitar that was cheap, and she was practicing on that guitar. I mean, every day you'd hear her in that room practicing on that guitar, and she had a friend that would come over and teach her how to play that guitar, and I mean, every day it seemed like she was back there. And so I just started telling Janae, we got to get her a better guitar. I mean, that's a good guitar, but it's not good at all. And we need to get her a good guitar. And she, because she's really devoted to this, she's really dedicated to this. So I said, man, this Christmas we're going to get her a seriously nice guitar. This is before I knew anything about the prices of nice guitars. Come on, somebody. It's a whole different thing. I went in and they're not cheap, man. If you really want to be a good musician, you're going to spend some money. And some of y'all are not good enough to be buying stuff like this yet. You need to practice a little. Like, you know, come on, somebody. Don't go out and spend that money before you know you can do this. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm telling you, I went to that store at Guitar Centers. The devil is the place of the enemy. And I went in there, and there's the cheap guitars, and then there's a room that's closed with the door. There's a door in between the cheap guitars and the really good guitars. And so I said, hey, let's go in this room, because it just looks so appealing. I didn't know what that meant. I walked in that room, and I was playing on these guitars, and I was like, oh, this is a nice guitar. Oh, this is not that nice. I don't like it that much. So we walked out. We said, look, we're not going to do that. That's going to be a sacrifice for us at this point. We're not going to do that. So let's just look around for something cheaper. And, you know, because we, you know, maybe she don't even like the guitar. Maybe she ain't even trying that hard. Come on. I mean, she, you know, just her fingers are blistered and blood's running, but she don't need an expensive guitar. Anyway, so finally, me and Janae were in the store, and I really believe, because we were not impulsive. We went back and forth several times. And I really believe the Holy Spirit said, if you want her to follow this, line, you need to invest in this. So make the sacrifice. And so I was like, oh, okay. And so I got it, but I was mean because I made her think, never going to happen. I just told her, yeah, well, we'll work on it, baby. You know, I hope we can do it, you know, and, you know, I don't know, babe, I don't know. And just this was the whole thing all the way up to Christmas. And so we brought out all the gifts at Christmas. Y'all love the gift time, right, at Christmas? And we brought out all the gifts at Christmas. I don't know about you, but as I've gotten older, I don't even care about getting a gift. The joy for me, I say this sincerely. Well, not to my wife. I do want to get gifts. But anyway, I say it sincerely. Listen, I say it sincerely. There is such a joy in watching your family receive blessing. It's just such a, and to be the person blessing them. And so we brought out every single gift before that guitar and just kind of left it hanging there like it wasn't going to happen. And then she opened the guitar, and I mean to tell you, as soon as that paper came off that box and she saw the word Taylor, she just fell apart. Because you know Taylor Swift plays a Taylor. Anyway, she just fell apart. I mean, she just started bawling and people were taking pictures. Well, mom was. And it was like the paparazzi in there. Janae was all over the place. But anyway, she was just tore up. And I was like, yes, Christmas is awesome. My children are crying. It's good. And I did the same thing to Sydney this year with a keyboard. She really wanted a keyboard. And we did the same thing and went back to Guitar Center again. I'm going to stop going to Guitar Center. But the reason I love that is because I know I'm being silly and I tricked her. But I believe that's how God is. He doesn't want to just do good for us. He wants to do better than we thought. Well, why is it that we sometimes think that being a Christian is just this hard, difficult discipline? And listen, there is discipline to Christianity, and we do need to be disciplined in prayer and disciplined in the Word and disciplined to grow. But can I just tell you something? It's very important for us to stop living Christianity like it's some hard, mean-spirited, hateful thing. Listen, if I see a mean-spirited Christian, I run for the hills. I'm not kidding, because I don't think mean-spirited Christians represents Jesus. I don't think we represent Jesus when we're acting sour and like life is horrible and I'm having to go through another problem and I wish life wasn't like this. You know what really the truth is? If people looked at our lives and we were standing in faith when we were hemmed in by negative circumstances and we were saying, it doesn't matter what everything looks like around me, I know the best is yet to come. God has done good things for me in 2016, but I'm going to tell you something, He's going to do better things for me in 2017. God's done great things through our church in 2016, but 2017 is going to carry a whole nother level of anointing, a whole nother level of encouragement, a whole nother level of help for our community. I'm telling you something right now, the best is yet to come, because our cup isn't just full, our cup should be running over. But there's some things we have to learn in order for that to happen. First of all, we have to believe that the best is yet to come. Every year at the end of the year, my family and I, we start saying things like this. It's going to be the best year yet. 2017, this is what we said at the end of 2016. 2017 is going to be the best year yet for our family. It's going to be the best year yet for ministry. It's going to be the best year yet for leadership. It's going to be the best year yet for everything we do. 2017 is going to be the best year yet. And the reason we say best year yet is because we know 2018 is going to even be better than 2017. You say, well, how can you say that? Pastor, you don't know what might happen. It doesn't matter what's going to happen. Well, what if something really bad and negative happens? If something really bad and negative might happen. We might face some obstacles. We might have some difficulties. Someone might get sick. Yeah, but you know what? I'm not living my life with faith in fear. I'm living my life with faith in God. Come on, somebody. And I'm not expecting bad things to happen. I'm expecting good things to happen. And here's the deal. If I'm living in faith with Jesus Christ, understanding that the best is yet to come, it doesn't matter what the circumstances are around me, whether they're difficult or whether they're hard or whether they're overbearing even, I'm going to stand in faith, because in Christ, all the promises of God are yes and amen. And I'm believing God for His best for my family. I'm believing God for His best for this church. I'm believing God for His best for your family and for your children and for your finances and for this kingdom of God promise that He's given us as He's planted us right here in the middle of Canyon, Texas, to produce vision all throughout the area. Let me just tell you something. God wants to do something great in your life, and you need to start believing that the best is yet to come. But I fear that sometimes we as Christians think the worst is yet to come. I mean, I've watched people through the times that we live in and the hateful and vitriolic ways that people act, and it's just like we're gloom and doom. It's like, oh, everything's bad, everything's horrible, everything's going to get worse, and it's just going to get worse till we all die and go to hell. I mean, come on. Do we still... wait a minute. Last I checked, just because circumstances in the world change doesn't change God. Just because things change and transition in our lives, that God doesn't change. The Bible's very clear. Come on, the Bible is very clear that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So he doesn't change. Therefore, no matter the circumstances, my God is the same God, Jesus, who stepped out on the boat and he said, peace to the storm. And it just absolutely calmed in a moment, in a second. This raging storm just stopped. Why? Because Jesus has that kind of power. So if Jesus can do that and he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, why can't he step into your life and the edge of your life and speak to the storms that are surrounding your life and say, stop. In the name of Jesus, stop. You know what? We need to start walking in our authority and expecting God's power to move in our lives. How many of you still believe in the power of God, the presence of God, to change your circumstances? The best is yet to come. I love how Jesus is always, the best is always yet to come with Jesus. You think Jesus has done something great, you don't even know yet. You don't even know he's going to do something better. You think Jesus is going to see you through a problem, he's going to do something better. Can I tell you, Jesus wants you to have a good life. John 10:10 says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come to give you life and life more abundant. The word abundant there means superior in quality and super abundant in quantity. In other words, Jesus is saying, I want to give you life that is just immeasurable. I want to give you so much life filled with joy, filled with peace, filled with rest, filled with grace. I want to give you life that you have to find content. I love how this in Romans reads here in Romans 5 where it says, we can't find enough containers to fill up. To catch the overflow of what God's Holy Spirit is doing in our life. Well, why am I not living like that? I don't know. Why aren't you?
Yeah. Come on.
Now, you fixing to turn into one of those prosperity preachers? No. But I do believe in prosperity. But I don't believe prosperity is just about money and getting and consuming things on your own lust. I believe prosperity means it has to do with your relationship prospering, your intimacy with God prospering, your family prospering, your mental capacities prospering, your career prospering, your health prospering. The Apostle Paul or the Apostle John wrote in 3 John 2, I would that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. Well, let's not take that out of the Bible because some televangelists made us mad. God wants you to have good life, life filled with love, life filled with passion, life filled with good things. No more sour pickle Christians. You know you've met them. You've met them. We ain't got none in the church, not in Summit Church. This is for people on the podcast. You know. Or maybe the person sitting next to you, right? You're like, man, I'm glad you're here to hear this. Sour pickle, I'm going to get you a t-shirt. Sour pickle. That's what we ought to do. That's what we ought to do. We ought to make a t-shirt that says sour pickle. And every time we meet a Christian like that, just hand it to him. Hey, I love you, brother. Here you go. Man, why? Why when we have the King of Kings living in our life? Why when we have Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, who is the author of life, living in us? Why when we have all of this, would we ever look at life based on and through the perspective of the sour things that happen in life? No. I'm looking at the best is yet to come. No matter what has happened to me before, the best is yet to come. No matter what great things God has done in my life, the best is yet to come. The good things that God has done. You know what? We have a problem sometimes. The problem is we can't get God's best because we're too stuck with the good. God does good things in our life and we like it. And so we want to stay there. How many of you have ever had that feeling? We talked a little bit about this in our small group this week. How many of you have had that feeling, man, things are going too good. Something bad about to happen. Come on, somebody. That's thinking with fate, not faith. We don't believe in luck. We believe in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Sure, bad things are going to come to us, but that's the whole thing about serving God. I can stand in the middle of the context of bad things and see God give me peace anyway. God give me joy anyway. God give me grace anyway. Come on, somebody. Y'all better get into this message this morning because it's almost over. The best is yet to come. Jesus, in this passage of scripture in Mark chapter 5, he's being thronged. I'm not going to take you there, but you can look at it later. It's Mark chapter 5, verse 21 through 24. He's being thronged. This means he is completely surrounded by people trying to touch him, trying to get around him, trying to be in his presence, because he's gone through and healed people, and he's taught things like no one's ever heard before, and he's done things that are miraculous, and people are like, I've got to get around this guy. He's unbelievable. And that's exactly what he did. They were all just, he was in the streets, and they were all just around him, pressing in on him. And in the process of this, there's a person who is a leader in their religious ranks and a leader in the temple, and his name was Jairus, and he came to Jesus, and he was in such a desperate state that he forgot himself. He forgot how proud he was supposed to be, or how religiously upstanding he was supposed to be, or his status in the community. You know what I've noticed? We kind of seem to forget. If you get desperate enough, you forget how proud you're supposed to be. Come on, somebody. Sometimes our pride gets in the way. We're holding on to the good, trying to control. I just want to stay right here. I don't want anything to grow. I don't want anything to move. I want my kids to act just like this from now on. I want my life to be just like this. I want to have this amount of money in the bank. So let's say everybody just stay still. That's not the kind of life God wants you to live. He wants you to live that life reaching for more, reaching for spiritual change, reaching for growth, reaching for goodness, reaching that you're not only benefiting yourself, that what's going on in you starts overflowing into the lives of other people. God wants you to live a life of adventure, that you're excited to get up in the morning, that you're not just, dragging out of bed. Oh, I've got to go do my job. No, I'm excited to get up because what is it God's going to use me to do today? Whose life is going to be impacted because I'm up this morning? What devils are running from the hills? Because I'm going to tell you right now, when I get up in the morning, devils start running. I'm not kidding you. I believe that. I'm telling you, I've seen that in my life. Why? Because I'm not sitting there going, oh, I hope the devil doesn't wake up today. Yeah. The devil's saying, oh, I hope Gadberry doesn't get up today. Yeah. Ooh. I'm a little stirred because I really do believe the best is yet to come for you. Yeah. The best is yet to come for this church, obviously, but the best is yet to come for you, for your family, for your future, for what God wants to do in your life. God wants you to live that life of adventure that causes you to spring out of bed in the morning and say, I'm ready to tackle the world because God is on my side, because God has empowered me, because God has given me purpose. I'm no longer looking at my career as my purpose, but I'm looking at my career as my platform for His purpose. God really wants to do something significant in our life, but we've got to live it based on our expectations for something great happening, not just an expectation that I guess this is life, and life is going to be hard, and life's going to be difficult, and so silly. So Jesus is walking, and Jairus is a leader, but he forgets himself, and he throws himself at Jesus' feet, and he says, my daughter is sick unto death. I need you to come to my house. Now, can I just say something to you? Why do we think God doesn't want to help us? Why do we have this religious mindset that said this must just be the will of God, that all this horrible stuff is happening among? Whoever has told you that, stop listening to them. We have problems and experiences and issues in life because the world has fallen in sin, because this is an imperfect world, and because people are imperfect, and because circumstances are imperfect. But it's not because God's not making you sick so you can learn a lesson. That is nowhere in the Bible. If that's true, then why didn't Jesus walk around making people sick? The Bible said he walked around healing people. He didn't walk around making people sick. He didn't walk up to somebody and say, I really think you need to learn patience. You're blind. That's not the nature of God. God wants to do good things for you. God wants to bless your life. God wants to use your life. He wants you to love life. We have a saying here, love God, love people, And we sometimes forget the last one. Love life. Come on, smile at me. I just want to know if you love life. Just smile at me. I do, Pastor, but I don't love it when you make me do this kind of stuff. Love life. So Jairus comes to Jesus, please come and help me. And you know what Jesus' response was? He didn't say, no, Jairus, you didn't come to me in the right way. You didn't come to me. You embarrassed me. You're laying on the ground. Get up. He didn't say no. You didn't handle this. He didn't say no. I'm not coming to your house because I don't think you deserve it. He didn't say no. I'm not coming to your house. He didn't say anything. The Bible just said when he asked Jesus to come to his house, he was so desperate, Jesus just went. Why do you think Jesus doesn't want to help you? Well, I've messed up and I've made mistakes. Well, of course you have, but that's okay. Jesus still loves you. He still wants to help you. He wants to help you get over those mistakes and failures that you've made. But he's not going to say, I'm not going to help you now because you're not worthy. Man, that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Listen to me. He cried out to Jesus and Jesus just started going. And this is what's so awesome about Jesus. He was going to do something great. On his way to do something great, there was a woman. Now, remember, this woman was, she had a hemorrhage in her body for 12 years. She was weak. She was an outcast because of her disease had to do with blood, and it would be considered unclean. And so no one could touch her. They'd have to go through a ceremonial cleansing. It was just, you stay away from us. You stay at home. She was not only sick, but she was broke because she'd gone to all the doctors. And the Bible gives indication that they had taken advantage of her, knowing that they couldn't fix her problem. They just continued to take her money until she was not only sick, now she was broke. And not only that, she was outcast. So she was turned away by the religious. She was turned away by the people in her life. She was limited because she had no financial resources anymore, and she was sick and weak. But she had heard that Jesus was a miracle worker. She had heard that Jesus could change her life. And so she began the process of getting to him. And she said to herself, listen to me, she said to herself, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, if I could just touch him, I don't need to talk to him. I don't need him to pay attention to me. I don't need to be the focus of everybody's attention. All I need is if I can just get to him, he don't even have to know I'm there. I'll just reach out and touch his garment. And I know because of his power that everything will be changed on the inside of me. Listen to me. That's how powerful our God is. And especially he's that powerful when that's how powerful our faith is. I got to finish. Don't take my time. She said, I just got to touch him. If I could just touch him. And now we, in our mind, we think because we just look at the Bible as just a little story. And so we look at this like somehow she just walked up to him one day and touched him. I'm well. But we're not taking into context what this must have been like. Thousands of people surrounding Jesus, pressed in on him. She's weak. She's devastated. She's broke. She's at her wit's end. Have you ever been at your wit's end? I mean, you're like tying a knot in the end of the rope just so you can hang on. You know, I got nothing left. This is it. If this don't work, I got nothing. And that's exactly where she was in life. She was just absolutely devastated. But she presses. I wonder how long it took her to get through that crowd. I wonder how many people yelled at her or rebuked her or told her, you go home. You're not supposed to be out here. I wonder how many people said, don't touch me, and made her feel filthy. I wonder how many people got in her way. I wonder how she got there. I wonder if it didn't take her 30 minutes or 45 minutes or 2 hours or half the day to even get too close enough to Jesus to touch him. I wonder how many times she fell down and was eating dirt and dust in her mouth. I wonder how many times she fell down and was surrounded by the dirty feet of every single person that was walking around her that didn't love her enough or care enough about her to help her up and get her to Jesus. I wonder how long it took, and I wonder how persistent she was, and I wonder how determined in her mind she had to be that every time she fell and every time she felt hemmed in and every time something went wrong, in her mind she kept saying, the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. If I could just touch him, if I could just get close to him. Can I tell you that you can get so close to Jesus with your faith that even without him paying attention to you, he could heal you. He never turned around. When she finally got there and touched the hem of his garment, he never even acknowledged her. He didn't even know she was there. There were people touching him all over the place, and nothing was happening because they weren't touching him in faith. They weren't touching him knowing that they were there because he was a novelty. They were there because he could communicate well. They were there because he was different than other people. They weren't there because they trusted him. They were still trying to figure him out. And in that moment, as she reached out and touched the hem of his garment, he said, "Who touched me?" And I'm sure the disciples stepped back and said, "Jesus, sometimes you're so crazy. What do you mean, who touched you? There are thousands of people touching you. Everybody's touching you." He said, No. Everybody's touching me, but nobody's touching me. You hear me? Everybody's touching me, but nobody's touching me. You hear what I'm saying, church? Coming in here to worship, coming in here to lift up your hands, coming in here to see God. Everybody's touching me, but nobody's touching me. Are we really extending our faith, believing God is going to do something great? Are we really extending our faith, believing God is going to save that loved one that we've been so desperately wanting to get saved, but all these years won't get saved? Are we really extending our faith, believing that that friend is no longer going to be lost, but they're going to be found? Are we really believing, extending our faith, that that healing is going to come? Are we really extending our faith, believing that that blessing and that provision will come? Are we really extending our faith, believing that the purpose of God will be manifest in us? Are we really extending our faith and believing that God's going to fill this church up and many campuses around the area? Are we really, truly believing and extending our faith that if we could just touch him, the best is yet to come? So she touches him and she's made well. Immediately she's made well. And he says, "Who touched me?" And she finally, because of out of fear of his power, she can't understand what just happened. She kneels before him in reverence to him and says, "I touched you." And here's what he said to her. Listen, if you read it in the Message translation, here's what he said. "Your faith risk has made you whole." Yeah. Your faith risk. Are you going to step out there? Are you going to step out there this year in 2017 and say, "Yeah, God did a lot of good things"? Do you know why we don't keep talking about recap for the rest of the year? "Oh, look what God did back in 2016. Because we're not looking backwards. Yeah. This is it. You just saw it. I'm glad you were here. Because we ain't talking about it again. Why? Because we're looking at what God's about to do in 2017. What's he going to do in your life? What's he going to do in your family? What's he going to do in your business? What's he going to do in your career? What's he going to do in your family, your kids, your marriage? What's he going to do in 2017? I don't know, but all I know is I'm going to get as close to him as I can, and I'm going to hold on to him of his garment. I'm going to hold on to him. I ain't letting him go. I'm going to be, listen, we need to get that attitude. I am not letting him go. I am going to hold on to Jesus. I'm going to be as close to Jesus as I possibly can. I don't care what the voices outside are saying. I don't care all the doubters and the naysayers and the cynics. I don't care. I know the truth, and the truth has set me free, and I'm going to hold fast to it, and I'm not going to be nominal, and I'm not going to be lukewarm, and I'm not going to be a set aside Christian. I'm not going to be cultural in my Christianity. I am going to be a sold out, dedicated, what we used to call on fire believer, that whatever God wants for me, that is what I'm going to do, because I realized something, that connected to him always, no matter what, the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come for you. The best is yet to come for your kids. The best is yet to come for our church. So I close with this. Jesus has done some good things in your life, but he wants to do more. Jesus has done some good things in our church, but he wants to do more. So don't let the distractions distract you. She had detractors that were religious, mediocre people. And they didn't like what was happening in her. They didn't like that she was would put herself, so her pride down, and dig her way into that. They didn't like it, but she just kept going. They thought she was unworthy and unclean, and that she just kept going. Don't let religious people in your life who want to live a mediocre Christianity, don't let them stop you from going all the way in God. Don't let man-made, man-imposed limitations and barriers, or even personal impose limitations and barriers on your life to keep you from becoming everything God wants you to become. Please don't let past failures keep you out of that intimate place with God that will cause the greatest things that you've ever seen happen in your life happen. Please don't let what other people have said to you or offenses that you've gotten by other Christians or non-Christians to keep you or hold fast on you. Throw the locks of that off of you. Throw the chains of that off of you and begin to walk in the promise and the presence and the power of God. Just keep stepping forward. Keep reaching out. Keep expecting and believing, and believe that the best is yet to come, because I promise you, Jesus didn't stop after the woman with the issue of blood touched him. He kept on going. They came to Jairus and they said, just don't bother the teacher anymore. Your daughter is dead. And Jesus looked at Jairus and he said to him, don't listen to them, only believe. And I am declaring to you right now by the power of the Holy Spirit, don't listen to the world, only believe. Don't listen to your circumstances, only believe. Don't listen to your problems and people that don't care, only believe. Keep your focus on God. Keep your focus on Jesus. And Jesus walked to his home, walked into the room that daughter lay dead, and he walked in and he lifted her up off that bed and he said, walk around, give her some food. She lives now, because Jesus never stops at just filling up your cup. Jesus just keeps filling your cup till it starts overflowing and touching everybody. I'm telling you, no matter what good God has done in your life, the best is yet to come. Man, you're yelling a lot, Pastor. I can't help it. I can't help it. It's hard to ask God to guide your steps if you're unwilling to move your feet. Next week, we're going to talk about the details about how we're going to move our feet. We're going to talk about what we're going to reach for as a church. We're going to talk about how we're going to achieve what God wants for us as a church and each of us as individuals. The best is yet to come. More people's lives are going to be changed. Our baptistry is going to be filled every single month. Our small groups will increase each semester. Families will be changed and impacted and reconciled and grow. We will help people in need more than ever before. We will advance the kingdom of God. We will fulfill purpose and destiny on an individual basis and a collective basis as this church. Because in Christ, no matter what hard times have been experienced, and no matter what good times we have incurred, the best is yet to come. God always can, and he always will do more. He's done a lot, but he will do more. He's changed us, but he can and will do more. He's provided for us, but he can and he will do more. He's healed us and he set us free, but he can and he will do more. He has used our lives to make a difference in the world, but he can and he will do more. So I'm asking you to set your faith in 2017, and do not leave this room today till you have resolved it in your heart that 2017 is going to hold the best for you. Best for your family. The best, because God is on your side, and no matter what you face, the best is yet to come. Father, we thank you for your word. We bless your name. Amen.